your city, but obviously some ramifications after the election in terms of the entire country. So I know that you're going to learn a great deal, and it's my pleasure now to welcome to the stage Dr. Jeffrey Sachs and
she's a little happy these days. 35. ideas later, but it took me a while to convince her that this was the right thing to do, that one person could make a difference. And my mom is a couple of the smartest people, and I know I speak about it at length. She's 85, she lives on New Jersey still. I don't call her at least once every couple of days. She sends me instant text messages. So just, I became a cop because I wanted a legal life and I wanted to make a difference in people's lives. And in 1983, when he came out of the police academy, I went to the New York City Police Academy, and I was a transit cop with three separate police departments back then. When he came out, he put you on train patrol, which was from 8 to 9 to 4 in the morning. And you would go trains by yourself. I rode the A train and the D train. The A train went from, I had a ride from 168 to Broadway out to JJ Brooklyn, and the D train we rode from 34th and 6th up to Bedford Park in the Bronx. The reason why I'm telling you this is I was pretty sure I wanted to be a cop, but after I got done my 6 months of train patrol, I knew it was the right decision for me. In the early 80s, it was a very different time. It's a very different time in New York City, and I think everybody would probably agree to that. As the 80s moved on into the 90s, things didn't get better in New York City. But moving through those train cars every night, you see the look of relief on people's faces at 12 o'clock at night, 1 o'clock in the morning, 2 o'clock in the morning. And these were people that were coming back and forth to work. These were people that part of the vibrancy of this great city. So I knew I had made the right choice. All three police departments emerged back in 1995. On April 2nd, 1995, the transit police became part of the New York City Police Department. At that point, I was a lieutenant. I had worked for Commissioner Bradley, who was the chief of transit police, and I had worked for him before the merge. I came here for the first time as the police commissioner. I got promoted to captain. I was lucky enough to pass the captain's test, and that's, I think, the road to really understanding what it means if it meant to be a leader in policing, and really started to have a big effect on me. I became a precinct commander in September of 1998, right across the street in Central Park. I was there for 2 years. It was an interesting experience. It's a beautiful place, a lot of challenges, an open and free society, a lot of things. Not a ton of crime in 1998, but it was enough for us to be concerned about. But again, that's a different place today. After 2 years there, I went to was transferred up to East Hall in the 25th Precinct, which is on 119th Street, Park Avenue. Just a great place to work. Police officers, I felt really dedicated to what they did. But more importantly, I got to be in a precinct where there was an actual community. And I think that gave, to me, that made me truly understand that if we can move forward as a city, if we can make life better for everybody, it can't just be the police doing the job, it can't just be the communities, everybody's got to be working together. I spent 2 years in the 2-5, and then I went up to the transfer into the South Bronx and kept going further north. The 4-4 is in the vicinity of Yankee Stadium. It's 1.9 square miles, it's about 150,000 people, and about 300 cops, and I was there for 2.5 years. Economically challenged. It was a place that I really truly got to understand what it meant to be part of the fabric of this great city. Cops were big, fantastic, but more importantly, the community was great too. I think I was really accepted by everybody in the community up there. As a matter of fact, I was in a community council meeting in the 4-4 last night. It was about 150 people there. When I was there, we were lucky to get 20 or 30 people to come to the community council meeting. So I think there's a sense throughout the city that the gap is being bridged. Nothing's going to happen overnight. It's got to be a result of the hard work of everybody in the city, because law enforcement is a shared responsibility. But I think we're moving in the right direction, and I'll tell you why. After I left the 4-4, I was in vice for a couple of years. I was in the narcotics division for about 2 years. In the world of policing, and in the world of, like I said, on the job, we had these ups and downs. When I was the CEO of narcotics, we had a couple of bad cops from the South that decided that instead of paying their confidential informants with money, they were paying with drugs. So then the commissioner at the time, Commissioner Kelly, transferred us all out of the narcotics division, and I was moved up to detective bureau where I ran the fugitive division for 6 years. The fugitive division consists of the warrant squad, the cold case squad, and the juvenile crime squad. And then when Commissioner Bradley came back, he made chief of patrol, chief of the department, and on September 16th, I became a 43rd police commissioner. Never in my wildest imagination as a young cop did I ever think that I'd achieve this position. But here I am on the first full day of the job I had in Charleston, 23rd Street. It was a difficult day, but based on the operational experience I had and all the relationships that I've developed over the years, I knew that that was going to come to a successful conclusion very quickly. We had something identified within 35 hours, and then the Linden Police Department confronted Mr. Brown after 50 hours, and after a gun battle, he was apprehended. So it's a job that was done very well, and again, not just by the NYPD, not just by law enforcement, not just by the FBI, not just by the ATF, the state police, or the prosecutors. We had real-time information that Mr. Rahimi had given to us by the community. That was our road to success. When I was a cruiser commander, it was a different model of how business was done. I had about 300 cops, and 150 of those police officers were assigned to sector cars. What that means is that we had 10 sector cars out there, and their primary responsibility was to respond to 911 calls. One second car can respond to 20 to 25 radio runs per night. That's one car, so 25 out of one shots. So where you think about where that model of policing is, and the police also have the opportunity to make a connection to anybody in the city. You don't. What you're doing is running from job to job to job. The other half of the police would be engaged in some type of summary law enforcement activity. If you do any of that crime work, if you do maybe some drug work, domestic violence work, or administrative work, traffic work, there's a lot of other things that have to be taken care of. And in that other half of the commission, it's really, again, no time to make a connection to anyone in the community. Never since I've been on the job, even as a young transit cop, we were always told that when you have to be part of the fabric of the community, you have to get to know the people. But in that prior model of policing, there was no time to make those connections. Neighborhood policing, we're in a different place now. The 77 precincts, I don't know if you know that, in New York City, neighborhood policing is up and running in 40 right now, and there are all of our houses and PSAs on police service areas. Neighborhood policing is a different way to do business. We resected each and every one of those precincts, so the sectors now form natural neighborhoods, and there is a steady set of cops assigned to each and every one of those sectors. So that means the same police officers every day. And that same piece of geography, so they have the opportunity to get to know the people that they want to protect and serve. We just sworn another 474 police officers out of the academy. And in addition to those second cops, we have neighborhood coordination officers, and that's a new position for us. There's two NCOs per sector, and their job, their primary job, their primary responsibility is to make sure that they. Second cops have that connection, they provide that conduit. By and large, we're getting great feedback from the police officers. We're getting great feedback in the community. Fairly soon, we will see on your phones, if you're in certain apps, that will pop up, that will come up, and it'll be a survey, and you'll be able to give you real-time information as to how we're doing as a police department. It's called the sentiment meter, and we should be doing something in the public with doing some sort of meeting. Fairly soon. I think it's embracing technology. It's going to enable us to know how we're doing down to the sector level, and we'll increase the commitment to be able to move forward with that information, knowing whether their police officers are doing what they're getting paid to do. We'll talk about one thing that really probably is the biggest concern to me. I think traditional crime, as most of you probably know, doing pretty well in the city. Violence is down, homicides are down, shootings are down. Last year in 2016, shootings were below 1,000. And just to put that into perspective, a lot of the new people I see here, you might not know the history of New York. In 1990, there were 2,200 homicides in New York City. Last year, there were 335. In 1990, there were 5,000 shootings in New York City. Last year, there were 100,000. JTTF, and NYC detectives over there. We also, over the last couple of years, we have to respond to what we have to be reality-based. We have to respond to what's going on in the world. We created two new divisions, the Strategic Response Group and the Critical Response Command, and they have the ability to respond in the event of a terrorist attack in New York City. So, as far as investigations, I think we're in good shape. As far as prevention, I think we're in decent shape, too. The CRC probably is even around the city. They're 4 floors. They have more than 11 CRC on them, and they are part of the Critical Response Command. Even most of that sensitive locations throughout the city. Being that this week is Holy Week and Passover, we're using a lot of our CRC personnel around the city and houses of worship. So we have the ability to investigate. We do have the ability to prevent, and we do have the ability to respond and document something like that does happen. We also have put thousands of our police officers through active shooter training. We're up about 7,000 now. Unfortunately, if something does happen, it's not going to be something from ESU, which is our emergency service unit. It's not going to be SRGSC, ZRC. It's going to be the Center of Cops that respond. We have to make sure that we have an expectation that they can win and prevent the loss of life, but we have to make sure that we're giving them the proper equipment to do that and the proper training to do that too. So that is something that is a great concern for me. We are a free and open society. We're doing our best to make sure that nothing happens to the great people of the city, but again, this is something that we can't do alone. We have to do that in conjunction with the people of the city. And I think that's why neighborhood policing is the way we're going to move forward. And the way that is the way we're going to move forward. Crime and violence in neighborhood policing commands is only it's at a low level in their traditional precincts. So at some point, we will have all 77 precincts in the neighborhood policing model. It does take a greater number of police officers, because the biggest part of neighborhood policing is to make sure that we have at least, the police officers have at least a third of their day with them responding to 911 calls, where they have the opportunity to actually meet the people in the sector, attend community meetings, attend association meetings, attend business association meetings, attend meetings like this, so they get to actually go out there and make connections. So I think that's an important thing to make everybody in the city a lot safer. As far as training, we've revamped our training. We hired a new deputy commissioner of training, Tracy DC. We put all 36,000 of our cops through a 3-day program, and a major part of that program is de-escalation. It's been difficult the last 2 or 3 years for law enforcement, and I'm going to speak about the New York City Police Department. Been a cop for a very long time. November and December 2014, through all of the demonstrations and protests in New York City, it was a difficult time, not just for us, but more importantly, it was a difficult time for the city. I think that we're moving forward, we're making progress. I think if I have any sort of frustration as a police commissioner, it's a lack of recognition and change in the reforms that we've gone through in the New York City Police Department. That's probably a lot of my fault not getting that information out. That's why I thought it was so important that I'm here tonight talking to you. I know there's going to be a lot of questions and a lot of different issues. Probably going to talk about body-worn cameras for a little bit too. Body-worn cameras are going to be operational up in the 3-4 precinct. I think the start date is April 25th. It's the 25th or the 26th. Working through the federal monitor, Peter Simroth, we've come up with a pilot project of 1,300 cameras that are going to be rolled out from April to November, and we'll have 1,300 cameras out in New York City. By the end of 2018, we'll have 5,000 body-worn cameras, and by the end of 2019, every police officer on patrol will be wearing a body-worn camera. The process was long. We had to make sure that we got the right equipment, and we had to make sure that we had the right policies and procedures in place as we move forward. So, I'd like for us to have a follow-up, not to have me up here speaking. I think we gave a pretty decent update of where we are as a police department. So, at this point, if you want to ask some questions, I'd be more than happy to do my best to answer.
We have microphones here, so please. please just stand up, and if you would introduce yourself and make a brief question. Thank you very much. And if anyone else wants to ask a question, get in line, basically.
Good evening. My name is Dean. I've been a resident of New York City for quite a while now. We're a few years past our coronavirus incident, and there's still a large chokehold on the complaints, and more importantly, substantiated chokehold complaints by the CCRB. My question is, given the patrol guide, you know better than anyone, has explicitly prohibited chokeholds for decades, maybe 30 years. Why are officers still using chokehold?
This is not something that in the rank of prohibition and control guide, this is not something that we do in training. I mean, way back in the 80s when I came through, that was not something that we trained on. And as those cases come through the CCRB, and substantiated ones come through the NYPD, that come up to me, there's disciplinary action taken in the morning.
Yeah, and to that point, I've seen some of the disciplinary actions on the recent CCRB report. 5 days vacation, 10 days vacation loss, sometimes instructions or training. Do you think that's sufficient or robust discipline given, you know, if a chokehold or a neck restraint is applied incorrectly, someone could die? So is that proportionate?
I look at each standard case, I look at precedent, and I make sure that when discipline is marked and that it's appropriate. So I give my one final order on discipline in the NYPD, so I take responsibility for it, and this is something that I don't take lightly. I've been a police officer for a long time. I've been involved in numerous arrests. I know what necessary force looks like. So I think I have the practical experience to make those decisions.
Thank you.
Over here.
Hello, William Stanford, Jr., King of Threats. I have numerous concerns, but I'm only issuing one due to time constraints. And that's regarding the parades. If I'm not standing in front of the frozen zone, I certainly appreciate if your officers don't stop me from standing in a non-frozen zone for no reason, which I mentioned to your previous commissioner, Willie B. I don't appreciate it. If I'm not standing in the frozen zone, I certainly appreciate it. Back off.
All right, I'm having a little trouble hearing you. What?
Okay. Let me repeat myself.
Okay, I'm sorry.
The acoustics are very
good. Okay, let me repeat myself. Let me move slow. Okay. So it does have a better. Okay?
It's not a question of talking slowly.
Okay. Name, William Stanford, Jr., King of Threats. As I told your previous commissioner, Willie B., regarding parades, if I'm not standing in the frozen zone, I certainly appreciate it if your officers don't approach me. Unless it's absolutely necessary. I certainly appreciate you eyeballing me, meaning staring at me.
Okay.
I don't appreciate that.
All right, thank you. Thanks.
Thank you, thank you for taking the time to speak to us. I appreciate it. I guess my question is a little bit more about the economy in general and how it relates to law enforcement. Like, we've seen a lot of great, you know, real estate developments in the streets. So we've seen a lot of them around the city areas. A lot of that is also, you know, rent. Young persons who might not be, you know, young professionals who have the income to survive in that area, so we're there. And we have machine learning and these other new things coming up with technology. What are you looking at in terms of security risks for the next 10 years or 15 years, where there are people who might not have jobs and, you know, might be moved out to the fringes? Is that a security risk that you're thinking about?
I mean, this is something that we look at constantly. We're looking at crime, and you actually have the ability to look at crime too. We have a CompStat 2.0 now that if you go onto the NYPD website and you look at CompStat 2.0 and you click on it, they'll have a map of the city, increasing by increasing, you can see where the crime is. So we make adjustments as to where the crime is. There's a system of accountability that's, I guess, in some areas kind of controversial. principle that I think is probably one of the primary drivers why you find it's so low in New York City right now, and that's Comstat. And it's what that is, it's a system of accountability for precinct commanders. So this is something that we're constantly looking at, and as conditions change, we redeploy people throughout the city. And again, this is something that the NYPD, we can't do. You know, we're decent at identifying where the problems are, but if we want to truly get to the heart of the matter, this has to be done in conjunction with the community.
Hi, my name is Woody Kaplan. First, I want to acknowledge Mayor de Blasio and the department in getting their shots and frisks. It's been a terrific thing for people to feel secure in the city. Secondly, I want to acknowledge and really appreciate your saying the words of free and open society, as you did three times during this talk. It gives me hope.
I truly believe that. And I've been a cop since 1983, and that's how I've operated, and that I'm in this position. It's something that I constantly reinforce.
In line with that, the absurd story that resonates with people is the fusion sentence and the one instance of it. And it's an issue of public safety in a different way. Was in Maryland when Governor Ehrlich decided he put together the state police and the FBI and Homeland Security and local police to make sure that the people of Maryland were safe. So they sent spies in to a group of Roman Catholic nuns because they were protesting the death penalty. And I bring that up as an example, just an absurd example, of course, to the fact that part of having a free and open society is the ability to know government in the wrong and to do so freely without being spied upon by the constabulary. And I'd like to know if there is that kind of a sensitivity training going on in your force today.
Yeah, I think that the way we've revamped our training, not only for the recruits, but the in-service training, that is something that that's an issue that's constantly being discussed. As a matter of fact, when I spoke to the new recruits this morning, I emphasized that each and every time we have an encounter with somebody in New York City, you're going to have the ability to change their life. I'm not going to sit up here and say that all 36,000 of our
goes on between policemen is a matter of, I guess you could say, loyalty to each other. So you have that going on. Then you have the obvious issues of the interaction of policemen with people of color and Latinos, Blacks, specifically. And you know, I hear your assurances that things are improving, but what we're dealing with is a very long-term ingrained culture that cultures don't change overnight.
Yeah,
so it, you know, and together with what I've seen with the conversations that I've seen between policemen and the community, I found most of the policemen, for all of that, they may have wanted to come across better, but I found them to be rather authoritarian and uptight, ultimately, and defensive. And for all of us who have something to lose by having a negative interaction with the police, it's hard for us to believe in that and to feel like, you know, that there, that change is really happening. And I don't know to what degree we can say change has happened because things are so new. But what are you doing to address the human heart?
Yeah, to acknowledge that the change is happening, you're going to have to see the change for yourself. Mm-hmm. And the ethos I want to see is not police officers taking care of police officers.
I went to a meeting, I won't say what borough it was, and good meeting, talked about a lot of issues. One of them was marijuana enforcement. I had, there was a member of city council that up and spoke about the inequities of policing in New York City and gave some statistics. And after the meeting, I had a group of homeowners come up to me and say, but that guy said, don't listen to them. We want these rules good, we want these rules enforced. So who do we listen to?
I'm not saying some communities won't issue complaints about marijuana possession, but last year the NYPD engaged in 38,000 freedom of interactions around marijuana possession. We know there were not 38,000 311 reports about that. That is a policing that comes either from the precinct commanders or the borough commanders or one police plaza. That's the only way to explain it.
And if you look at our enforcement, our arrest numbers are going down, our criminal court sentences are going down, too, the crime is going down.
Not for marijuana possession, going up.
Please, we're going to take just two more questions. We have an outstanding panel to follow. They come and the patient and I were grateful for the commissioner to be answering questions. But my understanding is I'm telling you, you may get your seat. Thank you. Two more questions. One here and one here.
I apologize for not being able to take all your questions.
We have a program that ends at 8. We have a panel, and we have the going to call panelists. Please.
Thank you. My name is Nassim Khan. I'm from the Bronx. I'm a college student, and this is one of my first dialogues with someone who's actually a police commissioner and an officer, so I want to thank you for that. I think it's important to have these conversations in terms of police community relations. And just like anyone else, I do have a lot of questions, but I'll stick to just one. So back in January, I do want to commend you for calling out on Donald Trump on his immigration anti-rhetoric, things going on like that. And you actually flat out said that none of your NYPD officers will be aiding and abetting ICE agents with the immigration going on, which I would like to commend you because provide a lot of security for a lot of families that's been here for decades. However, honestly, there's have been cases of NYPD calling and letting ICE agents know where the whereabouts are for other undocumented immigrants, including those who are going to federal courts or maybe even low-level crimes like hopping a turnstile. So my question for you right now is, are you willing to like introduce a system of accountability or something to really
there's an absolute system
to those families?
Yeah, there's an absolute system. Clearly established protocol for when we honor detainers and federal warrants from ICE, and each one of our police officers know what it is. I sent a message out, I guess it was about 2 months ago, 2 or 3 months ago, just to reiterate what our position is. There was a news article the other day about us notifying ICE. It was not a notification. It was each and every time somebody gets fingerprinted, those fingerprints are run against city records, state records, and national crime records. And if there's a match on a national crime level, it's not a reason to hold someone. You have to make an inquiry to see if that's actually the person. And in both of those cases, I think that's exactly what happened. So just understand my position. We do not engage in immigration enforcement on a civil level. That's not what we're here for. I think that we're We have a tremendous amount of oversight in the NYPD as far as we have a handshake decision. So there are a number of ways that I wouldn't expect anyone just to take NYPD's word for this. This is the work that we do is looked at by other agencies. The IG just came out with a report, said there was some administrative deficiencies, but the investigations and the reason for the investigations were spot on. That wasn't criticized.
That's the case. Perhaps you would work around the room occupy the
host. Talk is cheap, right? And
please join me in thanking the commissioner.
The accountability has to go both ways. And that's not what's happening. If we're having a conversation about how the heroin crisis is impacting communities in New York City, then we also need to focus on what kinds of resources are being employed. Right? So I believe that law enforcement should not be involved in people that use drugs. I think people that do mental health counseling, social workers, family reunification conversations need to happen. It doesn't make sense that NYPD has an opioid squad saying that they're using a new strategy to go after the dealer. Hello, it's 1985 and we're still having the same conversation in 2017, but they put a different window dressing on it and tried to tell us that it is the same or that it's different. It's not. I am a young black woman that grew up in New York City. I've only been schooled in New York City. I can't drive. That's how New York City I am.
We'll have a chance to ask questions.
people hear a lot of discussion about stop and frisk. I think when we think about police community relations, there is no phenomenon in modern city history that created more police community relations problems than stop and frisk. This was a tactic that was focused almost entirely on Blacks and Latinos. It affected an extraordinarily high percentage of the New York City population. For those of you who may have some familiarity with this, in 2011, which was the low point, there were almost 700,000 stops of New Yorkers, 90% of them were Black or Latino. And perhaps the most disturbing statistic at all, there were more stops of young Black men in 2011 than there were young Black men in the entire city. Approximately 165,000 stops of young Black men in 2011. At that time, there were only 146,000 young Black men in the city. And I think that what we saw was an extraordinary impact of that police tactic around the city, both most importantly the communities that were the target of that, but also the perception of the public about the police department's interest in police community relations. And as I'm sure you all know, as Commissioner O'Neill referred to, and somebody who asked a question and comment on that, stops have dropped dramatically. They haven't dropped as much as they've been reported as we did in police officers stop filling out a lot of paperwork that allows us to count stops. But there's no question there has been a sea change in the NYPD when it comes to stop and frisk. And we can only hope, and we do work on this, that this creates a terrific opportunity for there really to be a change in police community relations. There's enormous work that has to be done, but that change by itself creates opportunities that all of us should be looking to take advantage of and capitalize on. And with that, I want to focus on something coming, and Commissioner O'Neill referred to this, which is the body camera project. And as I'm sure all of you know, body cameras are becoming a feature of policing around the country. And body cameras have been sold to all of us as a key accountability measure. To be clear, we're talking about a piece of equipment being put on a police officer's uniform and video being produced. That is a very technical thing that doesn't necessarily get to the core of a lot of police community relations, but it has the promise to revolutionize the interaction between the community and police officers. Think over the last 3 years of the major police controversies that have rocked the country. There is one common denominator to virtually every single one of them, and that is video. That is video. There is nothing like being able to see what happened. Police officers tell a story that oftentimes is not true. The video does not lie. So we're now going into a phase in New York City where all of us are going to have an opportunity to learn much more of the truth around policing on the ground by virtue of the body camera project. Having said that, Commissioner O'Neill mentioned that there's a new policy, and it is true, and there are significant problems with that policy and the department's approach to body cameras. And all of you as active citizens and residents of the city should be thinking, as you hear about body cameras over the next months and years, here are some things to keep in mind. First, what is the department doing on police officers to manipulate the cameras? I'm sure all of you have heard of instances where there's some incident that happens and inexplicably the camera footage didn't show up because a cop turned it off. And we need to know, we need to be confident the police department is taking real disciplinary actions against police officers who manipulate the cameras. The second issue is the issue of public access to all this footage. As some of you may know, in Seattle, the police department puts it all up on a YouTube channel. And for those of you who like looking at police video, you can sit there night and day and look at police video. And you learn a lot about police in Seattle. Now, one thing that happens there is they blur it. They blur it to mask people's identity because of privacy concerns. that they have. And as the ACLU, we share all those privacy concerns. Because keep in mind, there are two things happening here. When you put on a police video, you have a lot of information about the way police officers act. But what's on the video? Who is primarily on the video? It's not the cop. It's all of us. And one of the real concerns that we have, and many people have about the body camera project, is does this become a tool for true mass surveillance by the police? And so as we go forward, all of you should be thinking about, when you think about the accountability virtues of body cameras, and they are real, we also have to think very clearly about the surveillance dangers of them. And we are living in a time, not necessarily here in New York City, although we have no concerns about that, but in Washington, where we have a law enforcement mentality now, where the idea of surveilling people, particularly in places like New York City, where a lot of people who are anti-Trump people, mass surveillance becomes a real issue. But setting that aside, I just want to leave you with saying, when it comes to police-community relations, we have, I think, a real opportunity to make a difference here in New York. That opportunity comes from the virtual elimination of stop and frisk and the introduction of the body camera project. A lot of things could go wrong, but I think we actually have some potential here as we go forward in the coming years to see some real improvements in police community relations. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much for those important remarks. And I'd like to ask Robert Gangi, who we saw a moment ago, we asked a question. I'm going to dock you a couple of minutes. But if you could come up and make some remarks, try to.
Practices of the NYPD are so ingrained and so long-standing that that only fundamental change can change things. Body cameras are only going to be used for the first goal. We saw how using body cameras work the other runners. You never get a body camera showing the criminal behavior of police officers as clearly as that video showed. And in every one of those police officers still work for the NYPD, almost 3 years after those practices led to the death of Eric Garner. Every one of them still works for the NYPD. Eric Garner's death is dead, and the man who took the video is in prison. So what are the optics of that reality telling you about NYPD accountability? So, but our point is, the discriminatory and abusive practices of NYPD and Kassandra did this over and over again, they happen every day. And they don't necessarily involve egregious acts of brutality, but they involve unnecessary arrests, sometimes outright bogus arrests, sometimes false summonses, because cops are under pressure from the quota system, they'll make things up in order to hit their number. And we see this through the work of the organization I used to work for before I became the manager of the Police Reform Organizing Project. It goes into the arraignment parts of the criminal court on a regular basis. And I'll just give you one example, and then I'll end my remarks and give you questions. We've made 6 visits in the last 3 or 4 weeks, 5 to Manhattan and 1 to Brooklyn. In Manhattan, the white population is 48% of the borough, and in Brooklyn it's 35%. Out of the 75 cases we saw, 71 involved the officers of color. 94% of the people that were arrested and that we saw arraigned in Manhattan and Brooklyn were the officers of color. Not one of them was charged with a serious offense, not one of them was charged with a predatory offense. Most of them were let go by the court for time served or come back and for another court hearing. So clearly the court and even the district attorneys were determining that these people were not particularly dangerous or threatening to the community because the arrest process would turn around quickly and they were more back. And that kind of numbers are what we've seen over 2.5 years of the court monitoring. And those kind of numbers reflect the impact of broken windows policing that targets low-income people of color for engaging in activities, often anonymous activities that have been decriminalized in white communities. And the reason I'm running for mayor is to stop it. So thank you very much.
Please, if I could ask the three panelists to come up and people that have questions, I'd like to ask all of them a question, starting with Frederique, which is, would decriminalization of marijuana be a major step forward, given all that you have observed about this? And is that being reached politically right now in New York?
I would actually say that legalization of marijuana is where we need to be. New York had already decriminalized marijuana in 1977, which means it removed criminal penalties for private possession. However, in the New York decriminalization law, there is a provision that if marijuana is in plain view or if it is burning, then that is a criminal offense. And NYPD exploited that loophole, and that's how we got to nearly over 700,000 people being arrested for marijuana in the last, during this time. And I think we have to get to a place where we can legalize marijuana, but I think more importantly, we have to recognize that the legalization of marijuana has to be more than about legalizing the plant. We need to figure out ways to continue to take away tools from police and different agencies for criminalizing communities. And so what does it mean for legalization package to include something that protects non-citizens, that protects parents. And I think we have to come to a conversation about what do we want the role of law enforcement to be in a health issue, where I pretty much laid out that police are a health problem. So I think we have to have a conversation about legalizing marijuana, but we have to have a larger conversation about how we want to change our relationship to the psychoactive substances it's a pretext for them to deal with poor people.
Is there any U.S. state that is going even beyond the marijuana legalization to the more general policy that you favor?
I think there are several states that are having conversations about looking at removing criminal penalties for drugs. And I think some of that has to do with the situation we're in around the opioid crisis. And people realize that we can't arrest our ways out of that problem because of the changing face of who is suffering from heroin addiction.
Thank you. Please.
So what I have gotten up to ask the commissioner about.
Oh, is this your second question?
No, because I didn't have to ask.
Good. Then make your first one.
So subsequently, the issue of marijuana has been discussed in other ways, but what I wanted to ask him was this. As I understand the Ronald Graham case, Officer Haste and his associates may have thought that the boy was engaged in some drug transaction outside the store, and subsequently thought that was serious and important enough that they had to chase him back to his house, break down the door, with guns out, why should they possibly have thought that this was something that serious and that important that they should have had to act that way? And on his side, what he apparently was so afraid of being caught with a bag of pot in his pocket that he resisted the command to put his hands up and instead ran to the bathroom to flush it down the toilet. Why did he have to be so afraid being caught with a bag of pot in his pocket that he risked death and ultimately experienced? Isn't this crazy? And I wanted to know what the commissioner had to say.
So I would say for that, I think it's really important to realize that a lot of the details that we have around the killing of Marvin Graham came from NYPD, and I think it's really important for us to recognize that the stories and facts that NYPD gave us, particularly about the Marley Grant case, have been false and not substantiated in any way. And it's actually a strategy for law enforcement to use drugs as a pretext to provide excuses for the way that they engage with people. And we saw that with Marley Grant. We saw that with Trayvon Martin. We saw dealing with regulated substances with Derek Garner. We've seen that in multiple ways, how they use drugs as a pretext to give themselves an excuse as to how they can disproportionately abuse and disrespect communities. So I think, you know, the Ronald Grant case is a perfect example of there are multiple stories of that he had marijuana, he didn't have marijuana, he was doing a hand-to-hand sale, and there have been multiple actions that have shown that we actually know the facts, and a lot of them are not the ones that have been reported. But I will say that there are young people that do run from the police because they are in possession of drugs, and it only escalates the situation between them and law enforcement, and people have lost their lives about it, which is why I go back to my previous premise, which is we have to have a real conversation about how we want to create accountability between us and psychoactive substances and who we think should be in charge of that. I would posit that it should not be law enforcement because people die.
There's a long line and we're going to have the same problem, so I would like to ask next to speaker, you can add or make a comment.
In general, I don't like to leave everybody with the impression that this is an occupied country, occupied by the police, which in part is true, but there are also a lot of criminals who get away with committing crimes, and sometimes there may be a complaint and the person who made the complaint is arrested. If nobody ever heard of a case like this, I am one. So there are criminals who pretend that they were victimized by their victims. And even in cases like this, the police can't figure things out even after several years. So in general, there are many criminals who are getting away with their crimes, and it's obviously a police problem. I wonder if there is an organization or some kind of group that tries to create a database of people who are victimized by the police in various ways, who try to complain when their complaints are ignored, etc. And people who ascertain their victimization but are not compensated, or police officers who commit crimes that they can easily compensate for on a personal level out of their pockets but refuse to do so or fail to do so. And I think this should be a moral concern. We are here in an ethical society, and some of us try to rise above the existing laws. And I think among them should be, if you are responsible for something, you should at least try to compensate for it and don't hide behind your badge or shield or whatever.
Thank you. Any comments?
What was his point?
The question is there a database of police victimization, and is there a system of police compensating those who are victimized and having personal responsibility for compensation?
Not in New York. If a police officer, if a case involves a lawsuit or litigation, and the defendant wins, and the case was a litigation against misbehavior or false arrest by the police officer, I don't even know if the police officer finds out what happened. Certainly he or she is not responsible for the payment. The NYPD itself is not responsible for the payment. It comes out of another part of the city budget, and is one of another ways where the NYPD is not accountable for its own problematic behavior. And it's a staggering figure. Last year, the fiscal year 2016, the city paid out $279.7 million in settlements involving police misconduct. That's nearly $280 million. And I think for the NYPD, it's the price of doing business. It doesn't come out of their budget. The individual police officer is not affected by it.
Thank you.
Thank you for your contributions. My name is Dr. Minsky, and I was a college professor and a criminal justice for quite a few years, and I have probably over 20 friends and police officers. I deeply appreciate what you have to say, but I think we have to be very careful about having this dialogue about these questions in order to be effective. And what I mean is, and I've been very upset that the governor, I've been using this up every class I teach since 2012. But there's a tendency to polarize, and my observation with the commissioner is a defense of, you know, I'm qualified to assess these things, whether or not there was accountability, whether we should be a question, and so forth. There's a defense posture. And then there's the case of Troy Posture that you manager also. What we do, you know, in order to diffuse those, I don't know, but I think it's something we need to think about in order to have a constructive discussion. Also, the question of credits, although it's essential and an important problem, we also have a general problem with this issue of training and de-escalation. Nationally, if you look at the police response, there are many people and kids, people of all kinds of race, gender, and identity, where there's an intervention based on something that doesn't even end up being justified for the person to be apprehended that results in violence or death. It is unacceptable. And my friends who are police officers are particularly afraid in New York of the other police officers who are not properly trained. Okay? And who are police. The police tell me this. That being said, I'm getting to your question. My question is the following. We have a problem with conflict of interest. The lack of accountability is so beyond unacceptable. If we're going to build trust, if we're going to have people who have been victims of horrible things in attempt to get justice, okay? We have to deal with the conflict of interest with the DA so there is accountability. And the mistakes that the police officers made in the case of Eric Garner should not just be left undone, and then the person in the videotaped it, he gets in trouble and goes to jail on drug charges. This is so unacceptable. So I don't agree with you, future running for mayor person, that cameras cannot work. They can, and we need to figure out how we can increase accountability.
Thank you very much. Maybe we'll go. Thank you for the comment. Please.
Robert, if you succeed the current mayor, it looks like Frankenstein, Don Best Page, and the Bee Gees. You need to help me maintain reform. As I told
tired of getting up in my face and telling them I can't stand in this particular spot or look suspicious to them. I'm tired of that bullshit. I've seen that happen to many people over the years. And to you, this forum was unsuccessful, and that makes you a poor excuse for a host. And how you treat these people who didn't get their spirit today to just speak to Tom Prendergast. Look, I said, look like Tom Prendergast. It's outrageous. You should have given them a chance to speak. That's all it is, excusable.
Subconscious bias. The research, as some of you experts I'm sure know, that most whites have a bias against blacks, unconscious, hidden, and called implicit bias. It's been studied and researched. And there is a way to control it. But first you have to acknowledge it. And many white people are under the pressure not to admit that they are biased. We live in a culture where everybody's got along each other and we can't admit it to each other. And the research I've gone through with police is they tend not to acknowledge their own bias even if they're in training. And at the point what Bob Gangi was saying and other speakers were saying, at the point in which police officers are directed to stop people for broken windows or marijuana, they're put under pressure, and it's at that point of pressure that the biases come out. And even blacks have biases to the police, unconscious and conscious. They have bias themselves. So the point of contact between the police officer and an innocent black person, there is fear, and that triggers off behavior that they're not in control of. And I think that so I'm wondering if any of you can talk about the present training that police are taking for dealing with this unconscious bias, which can be controlled if it's acknowledged.
What's the question?
The question is about
dealing with
unconscious. Oh, sorry. Thank you.
Okay.
Dealing with implicit bias.
Thank you.
Is this on? Can you hear me? Okay. The police department actually, unconscious bias or implicit bias is a huge issue. It affects everybody. The police department now is going through a training process in which they are attempting to train police officers in implicit bias, and the head of training now is actually somebody who is very aware of that. But I think we have to understand the limits of training, and at least one person before has talked about the need to change the department culture. That starts with who comes into the department. They bring lots of things into the department with them as human beings. This is a long process. The department now is starting to take that on, but I think we all have to recognize that to get police departments to a point where implicit bias is not a driving factor in policing, that's going to take a long time. And truth be told, unless we are talking about eradicating racism from our society, which is not going to happen in our lifetimes, it might happen in yours, that is a huge enterprise.
I'm going to make a point, though. It's a very important point. Implicit bias in interviewing police officers is a minor factor. And I agree with Chris that all of us have implicit biases of one kind or another. But we're talking about institutionalized racism. We're not talking about the problems or the faults of individual police officers, although certainly they happen. Some police officers are racist and are bullies and are sadistic, and because they have the uniform and the badge and the gun and they won't be held accountable, they act that out. But broken windows policing and the quota system comes from on top. cops who work in prosperous white communities, they don't have a quota. We know that because cops have told us that. The quota is only aggressively applied in precincts that are located in inner city communities of color. And so broken windows policing, the quota system drives certain kinds of police behavior that inevitably target certain communities and certain people. Whether or not the cop is a white person, whether or not the cop's a Latino person, whether or not the cop's an African-American person, or man or a woman. To succeed within the NYPD, you gotta get with the program. And so our point is body cameras, training, our best are tweaking the edges. And what we have to do, promote is fundamental reform. We have to reduce the power of the police department, the resources of the police department, the responsibilities of the police department. Kassandra talked about one, which is to take them out of the response to the drug issue entirely. They shouldn't be in our schools. They shouldn't be the first responders when there's somebody in psychiatric crisis in the community. It should be a social worker. They should not be regulating street vendors. They should not. There should not be a vice squad that notoriously abuses the rights of sex workers. Those are the kind of fundamental changes that will have a stab at ending abusive and discriminatory policing. To think that we have to end racism in our society in order to end discriminatory practices by the police system, that's a false dichotomy. We can end abusive and discriminatory policing by taking very strong steps aimed at fundamental change.
Thank you.
Can I ask you to ask the next question, please?
Stop bothering the youth.
Well, could you repeat the question, and then we'll ask the final comments from the panel.
Marlene?
Yes.
So Marlene.
No, the youth has to
leave.
The staff
has to leave. What steps NYPD could take to increase trust between young people and NYPD?
The school officers.
The school officers?
Yeah.
The school
Sandra was making this point when she talked about that the conversation should not be one of police-community relations. The only reason there's a problem between police-community relations is because the long history of bad conduct and racist conduct by police officers. The African-American Latino communities don't distrust or have antagonism toward the cops in some kind of, because they're born that way or because they engage in, delusional feelings of being persecuted by the cops. It's a function of what police have done in those communities for decades. And the only way you can improve community relations is by the police department stopping those practices. And particularly with young people, we know that the NYPD engages, partly because of broken windows, the quota system, they regularly harass young people in New York City, and it's mostly African-American and Latino young people. And Muslim American and Middle Eastern young people, New Yorkers of color, and that should stop.
Yeah, I would say that when we are having a conversation about having more law enforcement in schools than social workers, then we have an essential question of ethics about what are we willing to risk and who do we think is most important to deal with young people here in New York City. As someone who used to be a school social worker, it was always amazing to me the amount of discretion that law enforcement had in dealing with young people. I think the other thing, the way you build trust is you create a system of engagement, right? So young people are consistently harassed, consistently arrested, and no one holds law enforcement accountable for the way that they engage with young people. So how do you create a system of accountability between young people and people that are in law enforcement? How do we reduce the interaction between law because none of the people on the stage, I know I look very young, are young people. Like, I'm not in high school. So it's like, so how do you want law enforcement to treat you? And then you tell law enforcement what they need to do.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks to all of you. The staff here is supposed to finish at 8, so in due regard for their work, I do want to close our session at this time. I want to thank everybody, apologize for those who did not get a chance earlier to ask a question of the commissioner. I want to give a special thanks to the absolutely outstanding panel. On May 4, we will talk about another aspect of this issue, and that is the question of poverty and jobs in New York City, and we expect to have Mayor de Blasio with us, so look forward to seeing you then. Thank you very much.